Boiseans welcomed the 1940s with guarded optimism. The Great Depression that had wreaked havoc in other places in America did indeed affect Boiseans through bank failures and unemployment. Yet, Boise was somewhat isolated from the worst of the worldwide economic downturn, and experienced a tremendous amount of government help through a variety of New Deal programs. These projects had already lifted Idaho out of the economic stagnation of the Depression when war broke out in Europe in 1939, and American military spending helped double those efforts. For example, the decision to establish a new airport and move Walter Varney's municipal airport to the southern outskirts of the city in 1939 had a lasting impact on Boise and its residents. Vacating the airstrip on the southern banks of the Boise River offered Boise Junior College a place to expand, as St. Margaret's Hall had become too small to support the growing student body. School representatives had been looking for alternative locations when college president Dr. Eugene Chafee suggested the old airstrip. In the fall of 1939, Boise taxpayers passed a bond measure that supplied $260,000 that was used in conjunction with funds from the Works Progress Administration to purchase the airstrip and build the school grounds. The project was responsible for building the Oliver Haga Administration Building, the school's heating plant, a gymnasium, an auditorium, and later the Student Union Building and a Health Services Building. The administration building was strategically placed in a central location, parallel to the river, to allow for future expansion on either side. It was designed by J.O. Jordan and Son, built with red brick shipped from Salt Lake City, decorated with precast white ornamental trim. The collegiate Gothic style was mirrored in the other buildings across campus. Tourdelet and Hummel joined efforts with Wayland and Fennell to design the assembly hall. The installation of a new military airfield by the United States War Department had a similar impact on local engineering firms like Morrison Knudsen and J.O. Jordan & Son, which won important bids to construct infrastructure and living quarters at the Gowan Field Air Base. Some of these lucrative building contracts were awarded to local architects and engineering firms, who then turned to other local companies for their supplies and specialties, engaging Boise's economic and labor forces at a critical time. Morrison Knudsen grew tremendously at this time. When Pearl Harbor was bombed at the end of 1941, Harry Morrison's large construction and engineering company was hard at work at a variety of projects, including the Boulder Dam, the San Francisco Bay Bridge, and a military base at Wake Island. Based in Boise, the MK Company expanded greatly during and after the war and could be found at work literally around the world. The war economy brought folks into Boise from all over the countryside. The population had grown in the 1930s with the influx of Depression-era migrants, and after 1941, another 6,000 servicemen were stationed at Gowan Field. However, the population in Boise fluctuated throughout the war as servicemen and their families came and went. Of note is a small population of Japanese Americans who found themselves in Idaho after Federal Executive Order 9066 ordered all of Japanese descent off the Pacific coast. While many Japanese were eventually interned in the Minidoka camp east of Twin Falls, a significant number were also released to work in Boise or on farms in the Treasure Valley. The changing population did affect local communities. After construction on Gowan Field had begun, the Works Progress Administration announced an additional contract for a housing development to be located off base, 1 mile north of the new airstrip. In 1941, J.O. Jordan and Son were awarded $325,000 to construct a 100-unit housing complex located on 14 acres on the Whitney Bench at the northwest corner of Overland and Latah. The Whitney Bench was already the fastest-growing bench community when Sergeant City, as it came to be known, was built to accommodate Gowan Field's top three ranking officers and their wives and children. This World War II-era cantonment is a great example of the type of row housing that the wartime effort is so well known for. The complex was meant to create an off-base, family-oriented community that included all the amenities a modern family might expect. The units were built using standardized frame and siding architecture that made up a number of identical single-family, two, four, and six apartment homes that had furnace heating, air conditioning, water and sewer, paved roads and sidewalks, and ample public space that included a chapel, parks and recreation, and laundry facilities. Shortly after the housing was completed in 1941, 62 families were quartered there, many coming to Boise from air bases all over the United States. Housewives had the luxury of living amongst other military wives, and the airbase secured a regular bus route that would take soldiers and families alike to downtown Boise, where they were able to shop and entertain themselves. Today, only a few of the structures are still in place, but the community street signs still remind us of this neighborhood's important role during wartime Boise. During the 1940s, young men and women all over the Boise Valley were employed and looking for ways to spend their time and money. Clubs, restaurants, and shops downtown kept them entertained during their time off. While wartime rationing hurt local restaurants such as the McCann Cafe, which had to close in 1945, theaters became popular for their weekly newsreels. For many of the 200 million Americans at home, it was a way to keep up with news on the nearly 40 million soldiers that were abroad. Boise's wartime social service organizations provided an outlet for community engagement and growth, as young men and women all over the nation were dispatched and put into action. Every part of the community got involved in the war effort, as there was very little opposition. All over the country, service organizations cropped up. The USO and the American Red Cross established chapters at Boise Junior College. And here in Boise, Marion Falk established the very first Minute Maids, whose war bond sales strategy was adopted in other cities. Another source of entertainment and distraction from wartime news occurred up in the Boise foothills at a place called Bogus Basin. International ski hero Alf Engen selected the site for Boise's local ski hill in 1939, and a one-lane gravel road to the hill was finished shortly after by a local crew from the Civilian Conservation Corps. Bogus Basin officially opened in 1942 with one rope tow and added a T-bar in 1946. The first chairlift was added much later, in 1959, shortly before the road was first paved in 1962. Bogus, as locals call it today, has remained an important source of winter fun ever since. After the war came to an end in 1945, the Serviceman's Readjustment Act, or the GI Bill as it came to be known, was especially useful in providing returning veterans and servicemen with low-interest business, education, and home loans. An untold number of servicemen who had been stationed in Boise during the war returned to the area to marry and settle down. These young couples were in need of a family home, and this created a housing shortage in Boise, as well as in many communities across America. The prevalence of the family automobile drew the population into formerly rural neighborhoods, and suburban housing developments filled in quickly. The single-family home became the new normal as row housing and multifamily housing developments fell out of favor. Sargent City, once known as Boise's New Modern, fell out of favor for raising a family when it became possible for every family to enjoy the space and privacy of owning their own home. The bench grew rapidly as homes were built along the rim and filled in space between downtown and the new airport. Many of these homes were built in the ranch style or the minimal traditional style. Unadorned, simple, and almost box-like, these homes offered small rooms where traditional home life was emphasized, small kitchens, bedrooms, and a formal living room. As many were financed by the Federal Housing Agency, the organization's requirements for homes to be around 800 to 1,000 square feet and less than $8,000 created almost uniform neighborhoods. Complete with a one-car detached garage, these homes certainly represented the new age. After the war, soldiers were returning to the civilian life, looking to improve their future through marriage, employment, and education. Experience derived from the war industry turned to a pent-up consumer market as military spending contracted. Commercial culture took the place of the war industry as factories began producing kitchen gadgets, home televisions, air conditioners, and countless consumer products in the place of warplanes and ammunition. As a result, thousands of young men and women who had been employed in the war effort turned to industry for employment. A number of iconic Boise companies started up or expanded during the 1940s, including Boise Payette Lumber, Albertsons, and the Simplot Company. Jack Simplot started out dehydrating onions for food processing, and during the war expanded to dehydrated potatoes. Fertilizers followed, and today the Simplot Company is a major food and natural resources corporation. All these companies continue to provide Boiseans with both jobs and important products to buy. By 1950, Boise's population was growing quickly and saw its infrastructure expanding to meet demand, with new roads, rail and air depots, stores, and even a number of new schools. Government construction during the WPA era and the war had left Boise poised for the economic boom soon to sweep 50s-era America. Life in Boise was good, as citizens focused on community and consumerism. A writer for the Saturday Evening Post even wrote, "The city has no red light district, and police blotters seldom record darker deeds than loitering or overtime parking. For 2 years, no killing has marred the peace." While the economic and cultural boom of the 50s was yet to come, locals were poised on the edge of a great expansion. Indeed, Boise was soaring into the future as an important home of state government and growing national corporations.